Magic mushrooms, acid, DMT. When I talk about these drugs with a relative of mine that works in government, I'm told about how dangerous and illicit they are. When I talk about them with some of my friends, I hear about groovy times at summer music festivals. But when I talk about these drugs with other neuroscientists in my lab and at international conferences, we optimistically discuss their potential to change the world and to improve the lives of many. Hello, I'm Tommy, a Master's of Science candidate at McGill University, and I study the effects of LSD and how it changes the activity in our brains. Now you can imagine the shock my family had when I came home one day telling them that I started experimenting with LSD. But to console them, I spoke about the nature of my experiments, which I will do for you all today in a little bit. So you may have heard of acid, mellow yellow, or California sunshine. These are all slang terms for LSD, lysergic acid diethylamide, a compound capable of producing powerful hallucinations. A Swiss chemist named Albert Hofmann invented this drug in the 30s. He was working for a pharmaceutical company, synthesized this compound, and only 5 years later realized its ability to produce powerful hallucinations because he accidentally administered it to himself through his fingertips. And he described this, the first LSD trip in history, as an uninterrupted stream of fantastic pictures, extraordinary shapes with intense kaleidoscope play of colors. Now this drug and other psychedelics like psilocybin amazed psychiatrists all over the world. They realized the therapeutic value of these drugs because of their ability to enlighten the mind, to enhance consciousness, and to promote self-awareness. In the 50s and 60s, psychedelic therapy was tested and discussed in over 1,000 clinical papers, 40,000 patients, and 6 international conferences. Scientists all over the world realized that these drugs could be used to treat a variety of mental illnesses, things like mood disorders and addiction. In fact, LSD was shown to effectively treat addictions to heroin and to alcohol, so much that Alcoholics Anonymous even endorsed the use of LSD. As the use of these drugs in the psychiatric community was increasing, so was its recreational use. When word got out about the powerful hallucinogenic effects of these drugs, a psychedelic subculture had formed. People started taking these drugs outside of a clinical context with the goal of freeing their minds and raising their consciousness. Musicians like Jimi Hendrix, Pink Floyd, and the Beatles were at the forefront of the psychedelic rock movement. And you may have heard of the Beatles' hit song, Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds, which is believed to describe an LSD-induced trip. The song starts off with, "Picture yourself in a boat on a river with tangerine trees and marmalade skies." Now, psychedelics appear to be very valuable, but you know the saying, all good things must come to an end. By the end of the 60s, the use of psychedelics was endorsed by the American and Canadian counterculture movements, whose anti-establishment mantra challenged the authority of the government. And this led to the criminalization of psychedelics and their classification as Schedule I controlled substances. Now, this classification is designed for drugs with no currently accepted medical use and strong potential for abuse. And you heard me right. I said no accepted medical use and strong potential for abuse. This is how the government interpreted those 1,000 clinical papers, 40,000 patients, and 6 international conferences that all pointed to the therapeutic value of psychedelics. And strong potential for abuse. It has been shown that you cannot develop a physical dependence to psychedelics like LSD and psilocybin. And let's not forget about all the research that showed that these drugs could be used to treat addiction. The outlaw of psychedelics stopped all of its research and stigmatized these compounds. People who used or advocated the use of psychedelics were considered hippies and pariahs. Timothy Leary was a Harvard psychologist who was performing psychotherapy experiments using LSD and psilocybin. He coined the phrase, turn on, tune in, and drop out, which suggested that people turn on their brains, tune into the world around them, and drop out their negative biases of the world using psychedelics. And he was fired from Harvard following the growing attention the university was getting as a result of his psychedelic experiments. And President Richard Nixon even called him the most dangerous man in America. Now, to put this in perspective, this is in the same decade as the crimes of Charles Manson, the Zodiac Killer, and Ted Bundy. And I don't know about you, but if I had to be put in a room with one of these people, I think I'll take my chances with the Harvard psychologist. So, where are we now? Well, ladies and gentlemen, we are amidst the psychedelic renaissance. For the last 30 years, neuroscientists have been applying modern scientific techniques to reassess the value of these drugs. And recent clinical trials have shown that they can do miraculous things. Things like treating anxiety and depression in terminally ill cancer patients, as well as effectively treating substance abuse disorders to cigarettes and alcohol. Now, what about the side effects of these drugs? Well, it turns out that without a significant family history of mental illness, these drugs are safe, tolerable, and have very small side effect profiles. In fact, there have been no reported deaths directly caused by LSD, and only very few caused by psilocybin at exceptionally high doses. Now, what about the long-term effects? A study published in the Journal of Psychopharmacology looked at the association between lifetime use of psychedelics and the development of mental illness. And this study, they had two main findings. First, people who use psychedelics did not have an increased chance of developing mental illness. Second, people who use psychedelics in their life actually had a decreased incidence of things like suicide attempts and the development of psychiatric distress. Now, this study and its findings have been replicated several times, and these results suggest that psychedelics might actually be beneficial in the long term. So where does my research fit in this rich history of psychedelics and science? Well, at the Neurobiological Psychiatry Unit of McGill, I am part of a team that looks to study how LSD affects brain activity and behavior in mice. In one of our recent projects, we wanted to see if LSD could have positive effects on social behavior, something that is fundamentally impaired in mental illnesses like autism spectrum disorder and social anxiety disorder, conditions with very poor treatment options. Now, human studies have shown that high doses of LSD can be especially beneficial for things like anxiety and depression, but undergoing a powerful hallucinogenic experience might not appeal to many patients. So we decided to test a low dose of LSD using two regimens, a single dose and repeated dosing, which was once per day for 7 days. Now, in order to look at social behavior, we performed two gold standard behavioral tests. The first is called the direct social interaction test. And in this very simple experiment, we have an empty cage where we place a test mouse inside. And the test mouse is the mouse which had received LSD. Next, we place another mouse in the same cage, the intruder mouse. And we simply measure how long the test mouse spends interacting with the intruder. And what we found is that a single dose of LSD had no effect on this behavior, but a repeated regimen of low LSD increased the amount of time that the test mouse interacted with the intruder. Now, in order to confirm these findings, we performed another experiment, the three chambers test. And for this experiment, we have an arena with three chambers. One has an empty cage, and one has a cage with a mouse inside. Now, we place the test mouse in this arena, and it has the option to interact with the empty cage or with the cage with a mouse. And this experiment assesses social preference. Does the test mouse prefer interacting with something non-social or something social? In the next part of this test, we take a new mouse and put it inside the empty cage. Now, the test mouse can choose to interact with this new mouse or with the mouse from the previous part of this experiment. And this assesses preference for social novelty. In other words, does the test mouse prefer interacting with a new social mouse or a familiar social mouse? Similarly, we found that a single dose of LSD didn't change the behavior of these mice, but a repeated regimen increased both social preference and preference for social novelty. Now, in order to look at what was happening in the brain that might explain these pro-social effects of LSD, we decided to look at the prefrontal cortex. This is a brain region with strong implications in consciousness and social behavior. In order to do this, we place an electrode inside the brain of a mouse, and this lets us listen to the brain cells near that electrode fire. What we found is that a repeated regimen of LSD increased a phenomenon called bursting. Now, imagine a drum represents a brain cell, and every time this drum beats, this represents the brain cell firing. Now, normal firing would be the drum beating I don't know, once per second for, let's say, 3 seconds. Now imagine the drum beats 3 times really quickly and then pauses for 3 seconds. This is bursting. The number of beats over time remains the same, but the distribution of these beats is what changes. And although it might seem insignificant that LSD would increase this phenomenon, it gives us insight on what is happening in the brain, because we know which mechanisms are responsible for bursting. And now we can focus on our research on understanding why LSD specifically targets these mechanisms. So where do we go from here? Well, at the lab, we are trying to further understand how LSD affects the brain and which mechanisms underlie these prosocial effects. We are optimistic that our experiments can serve as the proof of concept that is required to one day treat human patients with LSD. If I can leave you all with one message from today, it's this. Let us not be persuaded to stigmatize these promising compounds with ancient pretenses. Instead, we should critically assess the value of psychedelics with the scrutiny of the scientific method. It's time to turn on our brains, tune into the evidence, and drop out our unjust bias. Thank you for taking this trip with me.